One, two, you count. Okay, so here we are broadcasting live once again from Tunis for this Tunisian International Tunisian Collegiate Programming Contest.
Yes.
And we are with Coach Abdelwahab to do the analysis of the problems. And we will be forwarding the problem, the one after the other. And he will be telling us his feedback of the solutions of the teams and the cracks that they haven't thought of it.
Okay. I'll start with the first problem, problem A. The problem is not that hard. I think it is the second easiest problem in the contest, but I don't think that it is solved by many teams. I think about three or four teams till now, only those who solve it. This problem says that we have start time and end time of difference, and we need to compute the difference between them in time and calculate the number of seconds we should press on an old video tape, VHS or cassette, that when I press on the key, I want to rewind the tape to a little bit to the back, so I need to know how many minutes I should press on the rewind button to reach the point I want to go to. It is one of the easiest problem. The only main problem in it, it has two tricks. The first trick is reading the input because it has a lot of formatting issues in reading how to read the colon or something like that. Most of the problems here is that teams don't know the difference between AM and PM, so they have a problem. And it has one hidden trick, is that the difference between 1 AM and 12 AM is 1 hour. So, but most of the teams, 1 minus 12 is negative 11, so they used to subtract the hours without checking the special case of that the difference between 12 a.m. and 1 a.m., and that the day starts at 12 a.m. and it doesn't start at 1 a.m. So they need to handle it with a special if statement. If the starting time is 12, it should be 0 or something like that. Like that, for them to be able to handle it. So this is the only problem in it. And also there is another problem in it, that they have to print floating point numbers so to accurate to 6 decimal places. So if they don't know how to format their outputs correctly, I think they will be having some problems in this problem.
Okay, that's for the first problem that has been solved by only 3 teams, and now we're gonna analyze the sailing squares, the B problem.
I think this is the 6th hardest problem or something like that. I think there are 5 easier problem. I don't know why most of the teams are trying to solve it. Although there are a lot of easier problems than this one. This
is actually mainly all the top 15 teams has tried in this, yes, and they hadn't make it.
Okay, I think it is. I think 2 teams only got it, solved it till now, but I think it is one of the trickiest problem in the contest, because of many problems. The first one is that the problem, the abstract of this problem is that given a grid of n by n cells, mm-hmm, given a grid of n by n cells, grid, it is rectangular grid of n by n cells. So if this square side is one cell, so you'll have n squared, mm-hmm, squares. If the side of this square is 2, you have n minus 1 times n minus 1 squares can be done. Until if you have the side of the square is n, you have only 1 square. So the required output is the sum of numbers, 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared plus n squared. But this number may be very, very, very large. So the output is required to be mod 1 billion plus 7. So to compute 1 plus squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared plus 4 squared plus 5 squared, there is a mathematical equation that can be do it is n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 over 6. The problem of division by 6 and you are going to mod this is not valid to mod after division division because the mod is not distributed over division. So there are two ways to handle this problem. The first one is to solve it using Java and use the big integer class to be able to bypass make the computation that may overflow, that should overflow even in the long in C++. So you must solve it with big integer in Java and make the mod at the end, or you must know a little bit of basic number theory, which is the mod inverse function that can be used to convert the division to multiplication under the mod. So if you know the basic number theory, you can solve it without the need of big integer. If you don't know number theory, you can solve it in Java, but you must use big integer, or you may implement your own big integer if you are going to use it in C++, but this is going to be very, very tough because you will need to implement division and mod, which are not easy to be implemented in big integer.
Right. So for this problem B, actually only two teams have solved it, and all the teams have tried it and failed.
Only two teams till now.
Till now, that's good clarification. So now we will be moving to the problem C, which is do you know that 1 plus 1 equal 2?
Yes.
And which is the red problem.
Yes.
Only two teams have solved it till now.
This is the third easiest problem in the contest. Actually, I color it red because I thought that it will look good if we found a lot of red balloons in the if we find a lot of red balloons in the in the room, it will look good. But
it's blue, actually.
No, I prefer to have red and blue and yellow to give a big contrast in in the colors and to be looking good, but to be loyal
to the ACM colors.
But maybe I was mistaken. But anyway.
Okay. So for this problem.
This problem describes some way of simulating a statement that is going to be repeated. The key to the solution is that the input is not that large. The input is 2000. The maximum input is 2,257, and this is a very, very small number. So you can compute all the results required before even reading the input of the problem, and store them in an array. Then just read the input and look up the result in the array and print it directly. So this problem, all what you need to do is just compute all the results till 2,257 and store them in an array before reading the input of the problem, and just go through the input, read the input and look up the array and print the result directly. So it will be much easier, and it is just basic implementation problem. I don't think it has a lot of you just need to read it, understand the English good, and
there is no issues with this red problem. And actually it has been solved only for two teams till now, and we will see
The reason of it not being solved is that it is problem C, not problem B, because most of the contestants are trying to solve problem B first before problem C. I don't know why, but problem C, B is much harder than problem.
Yes, and the difficult thing to understand is that teams can access the scoreboard and they can see that people are failing to solve the B problem. So, but they are always stuck on it and they are trying to it. So let's go to the second problem, Tower of Hanoi, a classical one.
Yes, it looks classical one, but the input is too large. You must print the input. The input may reach 10 power 18. The input may reach 10 power 18, so the classical solution given in most of the data structure courses cannot be used to solve this problem, which is the one that you use recursion to implement Towers of Hanoi. But if you implemented the recursive solution and try it on very, very small inputs, you will discover that the output is always 2 power n minus 1. Mm-hmm. So the number of steps needed to solve is 1 step. The 2 is 3 steps. 5 is 31 steps. 31 is 2 power 5 minus 1. So all what you need to do is to solve this problem is read n and compute 2 power n minus 1. But the only problem is that n may reach 10 power 18. So you cannot rely on any built-in power function that compute 2 power n, because most of them will fail or overflow in computing 2 power n. So the only way to do it is to use divide and conquer a strategy to solve it. For example, to compute 2 power 10 or x power 10, you will compute x power 5 and multiply it by itself. And to compute x power 5, you multiply x power 2 and multiply it by itself and then multiply it by x. And to compute x power 2, you are going to compute x power 1 and multiply it by itself. And to compute x power 1, you are going to multiply x power 0, multiply it by itself, then multiply it by x.
Right.
So it's a straightforward implementation of the logarithmic power function. The only thing you must know also that the result is required also mod 1 billion plus 7. So you must distribute the mod over the power. So when you write the power function, after multiplying mod before returning the result to avoid overflows.
That's right. So actually only 2 teams till now have solved the sign problem. Now we're going to the orange. Nobody has solved the orange problem.
This is the second last problem from the scale of hardness from my point of view. So this is there is only one harder problem, I think, than this one. I think it has 0 submissions.
Yeah.
Till now, I think I thought that it may have some submissions when I wrote this problem, because it is maybe a classical 3D geometry problem. Any student who took computer graphics graphics or knows a little bit about solid geometry should be able to solve it. The abstract of this problem is given some 3D points, and you need to rotate them about general line in the 3D and translate them in the 3D. So all you need to do is construct the translation matrix and the rotation matrix in 3D and multiply them together to get the matrix that transform the input points, and then use it to transform the points. The main problem in this problem is to be able to do the rotation around general line, not rotation about one of the standard axes. I'm not requesting to rotate about Z or about X or about Y. I want to rotate about a general line. So you must be able to transform this line to the standard coordinate systems and rotate about the standard coordinate systems and undo your transformation again. This can be done by translation, transforming system, rotation, undo transforming system, undo translation. And these five matrices must be multiplied by each other to make the rotation.
That's great. So actually, nobody has submitted this this problem, and we'll be back to the analysis just after this break. Thank you. We are back again with the analysis of the problems of the Tunisian Collegiate Programming Contest, and we are with Coach Abdel Wahab, and now we are gonna discuss the pizza order, which is the pink problem for this contest.
Yes.
So how is pizza today?
The abstract description of this problem is that given two numbers, how many ways, or what are the ways, not how many ways, what are the ways to get some certain sum from with certain distinct number. For example, 10 can be formed from four numbers using 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 7, or 1 plus 1 plus 2 plus 6, or 1 plus 1 plus 3 plus 5.
Right.
I will give you the number of the combine. I will give you the number of the sum and the number of numbers that I want to add them to get this sum. And you should print to me all the different combinations. Any student who will be able to write recursive code easily will be able to write this problem. And it should be a very, very easy problem to students who are get used to write recursive code. So it is one of the easy problem. It just needs some little bit of training on recursion.
Right. A great classical one, let's say.
Yes.
Okay. So now we will be forwarding to the white. No submissions on the white.
Yes, I think that no submissions on the white. This problem is one of the easy problems that requires a lot of code to be written.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you know the awards given at the end of this contest. What are they and what is the meaning of each award? Other than the winners of the contest, we have a lot of other awards. One of them is named the Extreme Programmers. This award is given to the team who solves the first problem in the contest. One of them is named the Solid Programmers, and this is got this is given to the team who solve the most number of problems from the first submission.
Mm-hmm.
So if a team solved three problems from the first submission and and the other teams, all other teams solved only two problems from the first submission, then they won this award. The third award is the Steadfast Gurus. And this is given to the team who solved the last successful submission.
Right.
The last successful submission. The last one is the Relentless Coders or Relentless Programmers. And these are the team who solves the problem after the maximum number of penalties. So this team will be able to solve a problem after 17 wrong answers.
Relentless.
Yes, and he gets accepted. This problem description is, given the scoreboard of the contest, tell me the names of the teams who,
mm-hmm. Who got this award.
Who got this awards. It is a straightforward implementation problem, and it just requires some codes on sorting and breaking ties, because if two teams are tied in the solid programmer, I solve them with the geometric mean if geometric mean of the times of the problems. If two teams are tied in the extreme programmers, I take the one with least number of penalties. So all what you need after being able to just being able to sort and break ties with different codes. So any team who can be who knows how to write correct code, I think, should get it. I don't know why most of the teams are not solving it, but I think it is one of the easiest problems. You know.
Okay, so this is the white problem that hasn't been solved yet. And let's get to the black one.
Yes.
The black one, no submissions,
yes.
No solved problem.
Actually, the black one is one of the problems that are easy and the problems that are put in the contest for the teams to solve it and not win. Because so the teams who solve this problem is not the winner of the contest.
Why? Is it because they will lose much time and resolving it?
Yes, this problem is problem requires a lot of coding to be written. It's a style of problem that they used to put it in the world finals, which is a problem that the solution is written on the text.
Mm-hmm.
It is an algorithm that you need to implement. So all what you need is to read what is written on the text and do it. But it requires a lot of handling and special handling, and it requires a lot of code. It doesn't have any tricky test cases. I am putting this problem for two reasons. To test the team strategy and teamwork. Because to be able to solve something like this, the best solution is to solve it offline, not on the computer, which means that if the team is three members, the two members should solve the rest of the problems, and one member should take about 2 hours or something like that on paper to solve this problem alone. And after solving it on paper, he should copy this code to the computer on 10 or 20 minutes, not to waste the computer time. So, because I always say that the contest is not 5 hours, the contest is 15 hours if you are going to know how to manage it and to make use of the man hour, not the actual hour.
Right.
So to be able to solve this problem, the contest must be 15 hours from your point of view, not 5 hours. So to be able to solve such problem, I think the best way, if I am a contestant, I'll give it to one of the three and tell him, take a pen and paper and stay
and don't tell code to us
until you finish the code on paper and come and copy it to the computer directly, because the risk of wasting the computer time and this problem in a very small bug is very high. So if you lose 2 hours of one man but not use the computer time, I think it is much better, and you will not lose much.
Right.
And the ability for you to concentrate while writing code on paper is much higher than the ability for you to concentrate while writing the same code on the computer, because you will always be feeling that you are wasting the computer time and there are a lot of problems pending need to be written, and the other two want you to hurry up. Mm-hmm. So it will be very, very, very frustrating to write such a problem directly on the computer. And one more thing in this problem is that if you write it on paper and copy it on the computer, so you read the code twice. Mm-hmm. Reading the code twice will let you see some silly bugs that will be easy to identify. So I think this is the only way of getting such problem easily accepted. And I put it in the contest to be able to test the team strategy and teamwork, not only to test their ability to solve problems.
Right. So after this black problem that hasn't been solved yet, hasn't been submitted yet, we'll be switching to the blue problem, right?
Yes.
No, the green.
The green.
The green hasn't been solved nor submitted yet.
No, I think
submitted.
I think there are about two submissions on it, and this is the hardest problem in the contest. The hardest problem in the contest for two reasons. The input is very large, 40,000. 40,000 is very large number on it. I'm going to describe the abstract of this problem. The abstract of this problem is that saying that there is air condition malfunction machine that used to have drops of water comes from it. Mm-hmm. So these drops of water are going to be when it falls down, there will be some obstacles in its way reaching the ground. Mm-hmm. These obstacles are modeled as straight line segments, mm-hmm. Straight line segments on the vertical cross section of the space. Mm-hmm. So I want to know the x coordinate of, I don't know if will it be. So I need the, given the place of the water drops and given the segments of the obstacles, mm-hmm. I need to know the place that the water is going to drop from on the ground. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. To be able to put bucket in instead of the water being. So the only problem is that the number of obstacles may reach 40,000. So the solution says that you need to know every segment should drop the water on which other segment. So if the water came to this segment, it will go to this one. And if the water comes to this segment, it will go to this one, not this one. So we need to know for each segment what is the next segment. Since the n is very large, so writing it with two for loops and using the standard n squared naive solution will most probably fail the time limit. So I'll pause the time limit. So you need to find an intelligent way to detect which segment that is going to drop the water on. So I think the best way is to use line sweep technique from left to right and just store the active number of segments, because there is a hidden limit at the end of the input section which says you can assume that there are at most 25 segments placed above any point on the ground level. Mm-hmm. So the number of segments that may share a point with other segments is no more than 25. So if you write a line sweep technique from left to right and make sure to detect the current active segments in the active set, the current active segments, the segments that have their starting point reached but their end point are not reached till now, you will be able to find the you will be able to construct the graph easily. After constructing the graph, you should topological sort the input and run a straightforward simulation. It will be easy after that.
Okay, that was the hardest problem in the contest.
Yes.
Now we will be forwarding to the easiest one, let's say.
Yes.
The blue one. So if you access the room, you have seen that on the live, the room is blue.
I think this is solved by all teams except one till before the blind hour, and I think he was about to get it in the blind hour. He has a very, 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 very small problem in his code, I think, but he's about to get it, and I think he should get it within the blind hour. I think his output is missing some spaces and some formatting issue.
Why is it so easy?
this problem says that there are n friends that need to eat in a restaurant, and this restaurant tables capacity is only 8. Mm-hmm. How many tables are required for them to be able to stay in this restaurant? So if they are 8, they will need 1 table. If they are 9, they will need 2 tables. If they are 16, they will need 2 tables. 17, they will need 3 tables. So you need to divide the number of persons by 8 and output the result, but you should seal the result if there is a fractional part. It may be done in many ways. You can check if the number of people is divisible by the number of tables to output n over m, otherwise output n over m plus 1. There is another way that you can change this to floating point division and seal the result, but I think this may fail if the input is very large. I don't think the input is large enough for it to fail, but I think it may fail. Mm-hmm. So this solution is not that safe. There is another way that you can add 7 and divide by 8. Mm-hmm. So if it is 9 plus 7 16 over 8, it will be 2. If it is 8 plus 7 is 15, over 8 it will be 1, because C++ and Java will trim the fractional part from the number. So there are many ways that you can solve it, but I think the easiest way is to add 7 and divide by 8.
That's great. So here are the problems. Here is the problem analysis that has been led by Mr. Abdulwahab. And now, the last question of this problem analysis. What are your expectations for this planned hour?
I think the winner may solve 5 or 6 problems, I think. But this is my expectation. I think we should see a lot of fives, fours, and threes, but I don't know if they will insist in solving problem B. I think with the scoreboard will be static, and it will not be changed during the problem blind hour. If they have a good team strategy, I think this problem set, if it is given in the region, there will be 6 problems which are going to be solved in the first hour, 2 problems in the next 3 hours,
and, you will give it
maybe 0 or 1 problem in the blind hour, if this problem set is given in our region. This is what I expect.
Mm-hmm. Coach Abdulwahab, thank you so much. We are really glad to have you. Thank you so much. And ladies and gentlemen, you are following us on our channel, broadcasting live the Tunisian Collegiate Programming Contest. It's the blind hour. You will be seeing what's happening in the room. There will be no balloons. There will be no scoreboard. And you have to stay with us till the closing ceremony to know who are the winners and who will get to the regional contest.
Yes.
Thank you so much. Goodbye. Goodbye. Merci beaucoup. Shukran.